Hi, I'm Rick Minter. I'm host of the Big Cat Conversations podcast, which hears from people across Britain about their big cat incidents, sightings and encounters. And we're going to hear of an encounter in a minute that I've been asked to introduce. Ed came to me at a rural show a few years back in Gloucestershire, and he's one of the 1,500 or so people I've heard from about big cat encounters. And straight away I thought, yeah, this sounds very credible, but it's also pretty dramatic because it's such a close call, such a dramatic incident to hear from. So it's very good that Ed wants to share it with the wider world. And when I heard it, I thought, I hope this does get to be shared with the wider public one day, because although in hearing about big cat reports and incidents, we always want to strive for more and better evidence, of course we learn from each encounter itself. So Ed is going to explain why it was so dramatic, why it was so profound. And for me, I felt that I knew that this area had got a history of big cat sightings. Now North East Wales is known, it's had routine reports in the last few years. At that time when Ed had the encounter, it wasn't known for reports, and it was really a bolt from the blue for him as a very young lad. 2 days running he had encounters, so we're going to hear all about them. And I think it's important to learn from the description of the cat, the emotional reaction from the witness, and just the lessons learned from that whole incident. And I think when people have close encounters, what I found is that they're more inclined to be quite measured and cautious about it, and not to be over the top and alarmist and to wage war on these animals. Close encounters tend to make people feel more measured and thoughtful and almost protectionist about the cats themselves, but certainly not on the warpath and wanting something done about it. So thank you to Ed for sharing the encounter. We're going to hear all about it. Over to you, Ed.
Hello world, my name's Ed and this is my big cat story. Now I know most people won't believe it, but I'm used to that. So when I was a kid, we lived in North East Wales, and we used to just play in the woods and the fields all the time, just knew every animal there was, not scared of anything. And then we dug a den, like a 6 foot trench, with an A-frame over the top and camouflaged it up. Just playing army, we were saying. But this one day, I was inside here, and my friend James was stood in the entrance, looking out across this huge mine shaft. And he said, "What's that?" So I just scurried to the entrance, stood up next to him. And just on the other side of the mine shaft was like a dip in the brambles and ferns. And there's this tail, a huge black tail, like this. And this big muscular back with the shoulder blades up and down as it moved across there. We just went, "That is not a dog," and just did the worst thing you can do and just ran. As soon as we started to run, this thing just started to bolt around the side of the mine shaft towards us, just barging all the brambles out of the way. But I didn't see its head, but there's nothing else it could have been. Now as we ran down the path to this barbed wire fence, we used to take ages climbing over every day. And there was the usual cows were there, just gathered, and we'd usually have to whack them with sticks to get them out of the way. But this time, they just went and scattered, just straight up the hill. So it wasn't what they were scared of, it was what was following us. So we dived over that fence, ran straight up the hill to our friend's farmhouse, told his parents. And they just said, "Shut up, stop being silly, stop lying." I thought, my parents, at least they haven't believed me. Nope, no one did. Just laughed at by everyone. So the next day, we were up at the same friend's house, but it's like half a mile away up a hill. We had this big water fight with my brother and like some of the other local kids. Even his parents were getting involved, and it was pretty cool. But got time to go home. It was just at the bottom of this lane, with a field on one side and a high bank with a hedgerow on the other side, on your left. And I just got this feeling, just do not walk down that path. Just do not. I was 8 years old and I just knew, danger, do not. So we just stood there, me and my brother. He was six. And he was saying, why have we stopped? Why can't we just go? And I said, no, something's there, don't. But it was the 80s, late 80s, there was no phones, so we couldn't phone mom. And our friend's parents were so strict, we didn't go back to their house and say, can you just walk down with us or something? We were scared to knock again. Eventually my mum came up, we walked down and she was just like, what are you doing? Something was there, something watching us, it was dangerous. But we weren't attacked either time, we weren't harmed. We did the worst possible thing and ran. Uninjured. He was 9, I was 8, and it could have easily killed us both if we wanted to. That was the intent. But I know now, I think it was a mock charge by a leopard. And it probably got to where the cows bolted and then probably just did a 180 behind us. So, and the years since I've met Rick, when I've been thinking about it all the time, and actively looking with trail cameras and tracking, I've seen one from a train in Shropshire, I've seen one from a car in Herefordshire, both sunbathing. I've seen eye shine in Cirencester, bright green in a hedgerow by the road with no street lights or anything. But also, I was in the woods alone, as quite often am, and about 200 metres ahead, I heard just alarm calls by birds. So I just went over to see what it was. And there was boar tracks. It must have been a big heavy boar, probably 60, 70 kilo boar. And those tracks just stop. There was blood splashed on the floor. Like a semicircle of rounded off prints into the leaves. There was no clear track. And then just a dry trail. So something killed that boar silently and dragged it off 200 metres from me in the daylight. Now, there's only one thing that can or would do that. That's a leopard or a jaguar, maybe. I think these are leopards. So if you're still watching this, this isn't the end, this is the beginning. So I'll keep you posted, because I refuse to give up until I've got evidence. The recent DNA evidence proves they are out there, so I thought now was the best time to tell people. I don't want fame, this is very difficult for me to speak to a camera. Hate it, in fact. Yeah. But yeah, thanks for watching. I hope you don't think I'm mental.
Dancing Shadows by Prometheus Beard. In British woods so deep and grand, where shadows dance on silent land, a sight unseen, a reality for me, black leopards roaming, wild and free. Their ebony coats, a moonlit grace, blend with darkest night's embrace. A secret chase amidst the trees, they prowl with pride, in darkness and mystery they confide. Eyes glow green, like stars they gleam, in the moon's soft and silvery dream. A symphony of whispers they weave, in the tranquil night they silently cleave. In secret glades they make their lair, a realm untouched by human care. Majestic shadows cast upon the ground, where black leopards in the woods are found. Their presence whispers tales untold of ancient mysteries and legends bold. In the heart of the night they reign, our black leopards, a dream's refrain. Thank you.
this is a nightmare.